Beyond her distinguished career as India's first woman police officer and 24th Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry, Dr. Kiran Bedi is also recognized for the impactful work of her NGO, Navjyoti India Foundation. In this virtual interview, we explored Dr. Bedi's inspiring journey, the connection of development with water, and her vision for creating positive change in the lives of countless people. First of all, thank you so much for accepting our request and being with us for this particular interview, please. So primarily, we'll be talking about water, especially what are your inspirations to get involved in the sector and talking about the water conservation initiatives. How did you get started and how important do you think it is when we talk about water conservation in the context of sustainable development? We are all talking about SDG 6 specifically. So how important do you think water conservation is?
First of all, I realized the value of water when, from Amritsar, when we came to Delhi, and I was staying in a bungalow on 2 Talkatora Lane in New Delhi, which was a VIP area at the edge of the Lutyens, Delhi, right? And there was no water pipe connected to my bungalow, which is a very nice bungalow, and it had a garden or terrace garden at the front. It had a kitchen garden behind, but it did not have a connection, municipal connection, for water from the municipality to my bungalow, due to which only water tankers came to my bungalow to provide water. And it is a VIP house. In fact, next to that was my member parliament staying here. Even he was living on water tankers being supplied. Now, because he was in member parliament and I too was in the helm of the Delhi police at that time, to get water tanker was easy. But at times, when it did not come in time, the whole house was not clean. The washrooms did not have water. The washing clothes did not happen, drinking water. Kitchen did not get cleaned up and rooms did not get cleaned because there's no water. And we did not have much storage because the tankers would fill the overhead tanks and it'd get exhausted by the rest of the day. And we did not have that extra storage. And I was in a 24 hours job. So when I was leaving home, I was very unhappy in the sense. Now my mother, first of all, my house will not be clean. So cleanliness, hygiene, sanitation, feeling of clean house, was missing because no water. So how important water was in my quality of life. And number two, while I'm at work, who's going to get the water for my mother or my home? So I used to then again pull strings to get the water tanker expedited when there was a water shortage, right? So I realized that I was worried about my mom not getting water while I'm leaving for work. And I wanted to return to a clean house and also wanted to note my mother not under pressure of no water. So you see, water became therefore a very essential component of quality of my life. So I realized the value for water as far as home management is concerned and sanitation and feeling, good quality feeling at home. Now I became NGO. I set up the Navjyoti India Foundation where Chandani Bedi has been interacting with you. And water was always very precious to me. So when we started to build the building, the project building of Navjyoti India Foundation, first thing we did and the plan was, where are the water harvesting pits? Because we realized that Gurgaon water was dipping. It was pretty deep. We had to dig a tube well, right? So when we dug a tube well, it was pretty deep. But now it was my interest that the water table of my vicinity remains high. Otherwise I'll go dry. So it was more from my interest, selfish point of view, that I wanted to work on the water table in the vicinity so that my water table, because water below is shared, it doesn't have walls and divisions, it's shared. So I had to work for all to get water for myself, right? So we didn't stop at that. because it is a rural development project in the Jyoti India Foundation, we started to work for water around in the villages. So we expanded beyond our own because we were here for rural development. We were here for, so Chandni, Ujala, her sister, and many other projects, they all had stepped in. And water was my priority. Women development and water. Now, women development and water go hand in hand. Because when women don't have water, they are not able to spare any time for any other creative activity. Children, school children, girls would not go to school because they did not have water at home. But we came there for a larger cause. Not to just live there, but to serve a cause. Because that was Mummy's vision, that you are, why keep the land vacant? Dedicated to the large cause. So women development and all this. So water harvesting, water development was integral to women development. It was integral to girl-child education. At that time, girls were being held back because of no water.
But when it comes to the decision-making, there are still very few women who are participating in the decision-making process. So what is your take? Like, you know, how do we ensure that women are also involved actively for the decision-making process when it processes when it comes to the water sector?
That's the role of the NGOs and the government. Where they bring men and women together. Don't isolate men. It's a community approach. And even in the women, you will find local leadership emerging. Some senior women, senior citizen women are very vocal. They're very strong. And they are, can lead. So when you work with the community, you will find people who are willing to stand out. So our approach is not to be isolate the women or isolate the men. Bring them together. Whoever is willing to take the lead, whoever has the heart in the right place. So our approach has been very, very gender togetherness. So there are good men and also the local administration. So I think once you speak to women, I've noticed women's leadership emerges. But they need a neutral person like us, an NGO. And they also need a local SDO or an panchayat officer, somebody or the other who can play the role. So you have to bring them out. Women will not step out on their own because then they're alone.
Yes.
But when you NGO comes in, then they're not alone. They have an institutional backing.
Right.
And then men also join in. You must co-opt men and women. We are not going to make it men versus women because everybody's a beneficiary. Families are benefit. It's a family approach.
Correct. Also, ma'am, there had been a lot of, you led several community-driven initiatives as well. Even when you were Governor Puducherry, there also, I think your Puducherry water reach model was quite successful. So, ma'am, please shed some light on this model and how did you bring the government and civil societies together as one platform for the success of the program?
Personal experience, NGO experience. Now I've come into the administration. And that to a level, I'm right at the top. I know my problems and I know my solutions and I know my powers and I know my responsibilities and I have the resources. I have it all. And if I have it all and if I don't give it all, then it's a shame to be there. So I got an opportunity from sitting in that position to use it optimally. Now, as long as things were going okay, it's fine. But a stage came in Pondicherry when I found that because of shortfall in rains in Pondicherry, Pondicherry is very, very totally rain dependent. And it's also dependent on how much water Chennai releases into the irrigation canals, which come from Chennai. So when I saw the irrigation canals in Pondicherry, they were all full of vegetation. They had not been desilted for years. And at the first instance, my gut feeling was, let me as an NGO donate my first 5 lakhs from my own savings to start with one irrigation canal. If nothing comes, at least I can do one. But I said, no, it will not be one. I have to cover all because it is a question of a 15 lakh population, which we have to cater to. So then I used my goodwill and trusting to the corporates. And I connected with the corporates and I sent a tweet. I sent a Twitter I tweeted saying I'm looking for support for one JCP or JCP's friends. And Satyabhama University called Maria Johnson. She responded saying, I'm the first one. I will give you 6 lakhs. Ma'am, you go in. I'm willing to donate for one irrigation.
So you brought basically the corporates also in this entire process together.
Universities, donors.
University.
They all came. And that's how we raised the, and good rains. By the time it all cleaned up, this is how it was. Corporate world, we didn't care. We wanted water. And no money dealing. And this is how, by the time I left, I think the water table was 7 feet high. So this is how that model was created. It benefited the entire community and also made the corporates very sensitive. They made sensitive to their role in CSR, corporate social responsibility. The model remains because the villagers have become very sensitive to their, and so have the companies understanding that if they have water, they can withdraw water, otherwise they can't. So I think it's bonded a sense of self-responsibility.
As the leader of the program, how do you, looking ahead, what are your long-term goals and aspirations when it comes to Navjyoti Foundation India? I understand that you're also building up a lot of rainwater harvesting structures across Gurgaon for the police stations as well. So ma'am, what are your long-term aspirations, your long-term goals as far as this particular foundation is concerned and the work you do through this foundation?
This foundation continues to empower communities. So water is one of the ways which we have come a long way, but we have to go on pursuing it, and which we continue to pursue. Water is one. Women empowerment is the second, where every household should a woman be skilled. She aware, she knows about government policies and that she's able to use them according to her need. We go house to house really. Some widows did not have widow pension. Just basically community security and community development. Widows who did not have the pension, people did not, poor who did not have the ration card, or who were not getting their 5 kilos of food, or they needed a housing. It's like a link between the government of the day and the people. And also training and empowering panchayats, training programs from panchayats so that they become self-reliant. We don't want them to be dependent on anybody. They want to be self-dependent. But we train them to become self-reliant, self-dependent. And with so many women coming in now, as sarpanches and punches, to train them to understand the laws, the rules, and financial literacy, digital literacy. So providing digital financial literacy, water harvesting, greenery, love for nature, educating women, ensuring women and youth get skilled. It's a holistic society, that's our dream, is holistic. We also have a nursery there where we want to now move towards training women to run their nursery. So it's all about community empowerment, community development, and many, many women have become rich, wealthy. They've even gone to Geneva and Australia representing their causes. So it's a huge development. It's a big turnaround from total dependence and illiteracy to literacy, commerce, business commerce, and self-development and self-empowerment and self-reliance and local leadership.
So one small message, ma'am, for the viewers of WD News and also the readers of Water Digest.
I think NGOs like mine and others must get MOUs and linked with Rural Development Institute. Interns should come here and learn. Many interns to sensitize themselves. And that will also provide a nursery for arts placement and job orientation. Today, government is promoting apprenticeships and internships. So I think NGOs and rural development institutions must become collaborative. So I would say this is the my message to that we need to work together, theory to practice.
So thank you so much, ma'am. And I'm really grateful that you took out some time and could do this interview piece with us.